of the campaign that made this law come about, and is working to make sure that the implementation is as good as it can be. And then the second speaker is going to be Lisa, Denethor, from Greater Boston Interfaith Organization, GBIO, which is working very hard to try to ask real people, can you afford the products that are being proposed? And so she's going to talk to you about that campaign to make sure that the law works the way we think it will. Okay, I'm going to turn it over for our first speaker, Melissa Cannon.
Pleasure to be here, and really thanks to the leadership of people in the legislature, like Senator Jalen, Representative Cortino, who really led the fight for healthcare access in the legislature. So you all are lucky to be so well represented, and we feel lucky to have them as friends in the legislature. So thanks for having me here tonight. As the Senator said, Healthcare for All is a statewide advocacy organization that fights for healthcare access. And we were involved in trying to push for the legislation as it went through the process, and talked a lot with these folks and a lot with Christine Barber as it went through, and we're continuing to watch implementation very carefully. So what I'm going to do is, I've told you about Healthcare for All, I'm going to give you a little bit of history of reform in Massachusetts, just so you can understand the context that this didn't come out of the blue, that this is something that advocates have really been working on for a long time, and there's somewhat of a history here on this issue. Explain a little bit about the factors in the last couple of years that made this possible, and then what you really all want to hear and what I'm going to spend the bulk of my time on is what the, can you see, I'm sorry, what the legislation actually does, and then I'll give you an implementation timeline, and I apologize, this is for a different audience, this outline, where I'm not going to talk too much about the national implications, but if anybody wants to ask in Q&A, I'd be happy to talk about that. I just want to get a feel for the audience. Who thinks they know almost nothing about this law? Who knows a little, wants to learn more? Who thinks they know more than I do and is here to keep me honest? okay, good. It's, you know, sometimes there are folks who keep me honest, which is great. I talk about healthcare for all it is. We do a bunch of things besides health reform, so y'all know. We work in a coalition model, and I'll talk about that and how that helps bring about health quality. We do that also on healthcare disparities, healthcare quality, oral health. We have coalitions going on all of these things in addition to sort of the comprehensive health reform campaign. Brief history of reform. If folks can hear me, I'm going to step back. Can you guys hear me? Great. There are a couple major, you know, there are, of course, always health care bills that are filed in the legislature, but there were two major waves of reform that preceded this one, just so you all can understand the history. In 1988, actually, the universal health care law passed. I don't know how many of you all remember that or paid attention to the issue at the time. But then there was, of course, a recession shortly after that, and so it was never entirely implemented, and it was officially repealed in 1996. It included a pay-or-play, employer-mandated sort of Clinton-esque sort of health reform, pay-or-play provision. But there were some things that came out of that health care bill that did go into effect and are still in place today that are really important foundations going into health reform this year. They include the Common Health Program for the working disabled, a mandate that students have health insurance, the Medical Security Plan, which is for people who are collecting unemployment to be able to continue to get health insurance, the Healthy Start Program for pregnant women. All of these are still going strong and are in place going in this year. In 1996, we saw another wave of health reform, most significantly with big mass health expansions. We saw 350,000 new enrollees in mass health because of those expansions, and what's known in Chapter 203. Particularly kids, the most significant expansions were for kids. Health so that kids could be insured either through MassHealth or through something called the Children's Medical Security Program, and the Senior Pharmacy Program and the Prescription Advantage was born in that law. And both of them inspired national action, as this wave seems to be doing as well. So where were we a couple years ago? About 500,000 people in the state were uninsured, and that number was growing as we're seeing employers either drop or reduce coverage for folks. We actually had the fourth biggest drop nationally in employer-sponsored coverage, and it's really the high cost of care that was driving those cuts, and probably all feeling that pinch of familiarity. they wanted dollars to go more towards insurance rather than towards free care pool. They didn't so much want Medicaid dollars for Medicaid, they wanted folks more in traditional insurance. Also, a big thing to help push for reform was that a lot of providers who have a lot of political weight in the Commonwealth felt that they were getting underpaid by the Mass Health program. And of course, in setting the stage, there's always players. Personality always comes into play. It's something that I actually really enjoy about the business of politics is that there are personalities that make things possible at different times. So Governor Romney knew he was not going to run again when he was running for president and was looking for a major issue. Sorry to be so blunt. Can I do that at healthcare for all? The legislature was overwhelmingly Democratic. Both the Senate president and the Speaker of the House were sort of looking for signature issues. The leadership of your representative and senator and other like-minded legislators were really pushing to get it done. So we had a good setting. And then we, of course, had the federal officials pushing us to get the waiver done. And then we had something called the Affordable Care Today Coalition. I told you that at Healthcare for All, we try to do things in coalition. And John McDonough, the head of Healthcare for All, got together with GBIO, Lisa works for the Greater Boston Interfaith Organization, and lots of other interested players in Massachusetts to really form a coalition to push for change rather than any one advocacy organization or one voice or just providers over here asking for this or business community asking for that, really trying to come together as a consolidated, broad voice pushing for reform. and that very related coalition was also pushing a ballot initiative at the same time in case the legislature didn't pass. So that's just sort of the politics behind it. You know, I love the game. How many of you are interested in it? That's what helped get it done. So when I talk, and now I'm going to tell you what's in the bill. And there's a couple ways I like to break it down. In my mind, there are sort of three types of responsibility that go into health reform the way it was designed. There's individual responsibility, which may be sort of the most notable sort of conversation-worthy piece of it. There's employer responsibility, and then, of course, there's government responsibility in terms of what government puts in, both federal and state. And I won't talk about the funding side of it too much, but those are the three types of responsibility. And then I also like to break it down in terms of three types of coverage. There are folks who are poor and qualify for MassHealth and what can be done for them. There are folks who are sort of working poor or, you know, mid to low income who are working but don't make enough money to really afford insurance in the private market right now. As you know, health insurance is expensive and hard to buy on your own. So they did something for those folks. And then there's sort of the everyone else in the private insurance market of what can be done for them, particularly people who have to buy on their own rather than the employer sponsor coverage. So I'll talk about the sort of three types of responsibility and the three types of coverage. So individual responsibility, you've all heard by now, maybe it's why you're here, that Chapter 58, as we call it, the health reform bill includes an individual mandate. That means that all residents in Massachusetts, adults, I should say, must obtain health insurance coverage if affordable coverage is available. And this is a big if, and we in Healthcare for All sometimes pin our hopes on these types of provisions. So there's going to be a real discussion going forward about what is affordable coverage and what's affordable to whom. But certainly the hope of a lot of people that there would be insurance affordable enough that the mandate would apply to everyone, but that remains to be seen. And it's a board, it's a connector board, and I'll explain who's on that in a minute, who makes that determination about whether affordable insurance exists. And so, like I said, there will be a real fight on that coming up next year, probably. It's enforced through the tax system. So when you file your taxes, starting in April of 2008, you will have to check a box indicating whether you were insured. Technically, you need to be insured starting in July of 2007, although actually on the form it'll ask you if you were insured on the last day of 2007. And the penalty is smaller in the first year. You lose your personal tax exemption in the first year. And then in the second year and beyond, in 2008 and beyond, you would be fined half of the cost of what's determined to be sort of the most affordable premium on the market. So if they determine that there are $300 products available to you and you chose not to buy insurance, you would be fined $150 a month for every month that you chose to go without insurance. That's all still coming responsibility on employers for helping to insure people. We live in an employer sponsored system right now. At Healthcare for All, we would really support moving to what's known as a single payer system where government assumes responsibility. But that didn't seem to be politically viable, given that we're in an employer sponsored system. The question was, what can employers do? This was honestly the most controversial provision in the legislation and what kept it from passing for some time. But the compromise was decided that there are three ways. The first, probably the most talked about how employers are responsible. The first is called the fair share contribution. If you're an employer with 11 or more employees, you need to make insurance available to your employees or pay a fine of up to $295 per worker. The regulations, though, that were promulgated on that provision set a pretty low standard. You don't have to actually, as an employer, necessarily pay for any of that insurance. You just need to make it available. And I can answer more detailed questions about that afterwards if folks are interested. If you don't make some type of insurance available and your employees end up using the free care pool, for folks who don't know, what the free care pool is? Mostly, okay. The free care pool is something, it actually is had about, you'll hear it called the free care pool, the uncompensated care pool. Actually, the name is going to change to the safety net care pool. But it's for folks that don't have insurance, who need coverage, who are quite poor. It's a way that they can show up and get their health care covered. And a fair amount of money goes into covering those folks. And it's called a pool because of the way that it's funded, which is actually kind of complicated and I won't go into. But if your employees show up needing these free health care services, you could be charged if a certain number of employees use it over a certain amount of time and rack up a certain dollars in bills. And all employers must facilitate a pre-tax, what's known as cafeteria plan, just basically a way for your employees to get insurance pre-tax. Again, not necessarily that you make a contribution, but just that you make it available. So that's sort of the types of responsibility. MassHealth, that's a name we use for our Medicaid program in Massachusetts. Medicaid is a program that serves people who are generally poor, as opposed to Medicare, which serves generally the elder and disabled. I know some folks get the two confused a lot, but we're talking about MassHealth, which is our state Medicaid program. And there was a pretty significant expansion as part of this health reform bill to cover kids up to 300% of the federal poverty level. That's about $60,000 for a family of four. So that means that a lot more children will be eligible for MassHealth and a good comprehensive insurance program. MassHealth Essential, which serves people who are the long-term unemployed and really have very few job prospects and therefore have very few insurance prospects. MassHealth Essential had a significant waiting list, and that waiting list was served by removing the cap on that program. Also, there were some important MassHealth services that people were receiving that were cut during the last recession, most notably dental and vision care, and those were restored through this bill, and we saw that as a really big victory, because dental coverage is really important to people's overall health. There's also money for outreach grants, and providers who had been part of this push were saying they needed more money, and their reimbursement rates through the Medicaid program, they did get theirs through this bill. So that's I talked about the types of coverage, and that's, in my mind, sort of what's available for the poorest folks. And then there's this next group, generally to the working, low-income folks as a legislature. And to me, this is actually the most exciting part of health reform, and I think Christine may have her own judgments, but to me, this is a really exciting thing that the state is doing, saying, okay, it's not just about MassHealth and the poorest of the poor, but really recognizing that there are working poor who still can't afford insurance on their own, and how can we subsidize insurance for them so that they pay some and government pays some as well. So they created something known as Commonwealth Care. It's also sometimes called the CCHIP, which stands for Commonwealth Care Health Insurance Program. There's always lots of acronyms in state government. So it's always a sort of a big naming rights game after the bill passed. And that provides insurance for folks who are uninsured below 300% of poverty. That's about $28,000 for an individual or $60,000 for a family of four. Again, the children in that family would qualify for MassHealth, but the parents will qualify for this subsidized insurance program. If you're below 100% of poverty, and those are people that don't qualify for MassHealth for some reason, there are no premiums, they're very low co-pays. It's actually a product very similar to MassHealth, but it's going through poverty. and that actually, we're talking about timelines, and I should have said this about MassHealth. The expansions to MassHealth went into effect on July 1st. The bill passed April 12th. Those expansions went into effect on July 1st. We saw about 20,000 kids become eligible for MassHealth that had not been eligible before, and about 600,000 people received dental coverage who had not been received yet. And that just went into effect sort of overnight. It was really exciting. Commonwealth Care is coming into effect in phases. The first phase has just started. Starting October 1st, people who are below 100% of poverty, that's the $28,000, could start enrolling for Commonwealth Care, and their coverage will start November 1st. For folks in the income category between 100 and 300% of poverty, those folks can enroll starting January 1st for coverage that starts February 1st. It's a pretty comprehensive benefit. It's good health insurance. The premiums are on a sliding scale, and I actually, one of your handouts hopefully has that on there. But the premiums are for an individual at the lowest poverty level, it's $18 a month, and it goes up to, I think, $108 for an individual at 300% of poverty. So, so the idea is it's a sliding scale. That number on the bottom of the screen is if you know anyone who might be eligible for that program, that's the number at Commonwealth Care to call. You can also call Healthcare for All's helpline, and they'll help you enroll. That number is at the end of the slide. Okay, so we've talked about poor folks on MassHealth. We've talked about subsidized coverage for working poor. And then we get into the complicated part. So if I haven't lost you yet, I might lose you here. But what they did was create something called the Insurance Connector. And I'm going to explain the governance system, and then I'll explain to you what they do. It's interesting because, you know, we had a Democratic legislature, a Republican governor, and I can't say why the legislature did what they did, but perhaps for that reason, they created an independent, quasi-public authority, a 10-member board that has most of the authority, really, for implementing health reform. So it's sort of a new experiment that, rather than just the traditional agencies implementing this law, there's this new 10-member board made up of appointees that represent all sorts of different interests in this. They represent business, consumers, and they do represent different agencies within state government. So they